I was in Tokyo in the very high building, and I suddenly felt the movement of building and getting increased movement larger and larger. So I thought this is, of course, earthquake and bigger one. First, I thought this is Nankai earthquake. Then I asked somebody, and they say, this is from Tohoku. And then when I came back home, I saw the news and I saw the huge tsunami, and I was very surprised and start thinking what we should do as scientists.
Goal of this expedition will be, we'd like to know the current situation of the fault line. And we already have 13 years since the Tohoku earthquake. And fault is shallow large slip occurred. And after that, we would like to know whether fault is started to accumulate strain or not.
What the engineers and the drillers are doing here is really at the edge of what's possible with the drill ship. And this ship, I think, is the only one in the world for scientific drilling, certainly, but maybe generally, that's able to drill in these water depths. So 7 kilometers of ocean is between us and the seafloor. Take a moment to think about it. It's astonishing how far it is and what they're able to do.
The logging while drilling will provide information about the state of stress, for instance. This is very important for us to understand if we are at the moment in a new step of the seismic cycle and if we are adding more stress on the rocks than before. So this is one of the things that we are looking for. But the way science works is that you propose an idea based on the data and the observation that you've made. And if you have only one piece of the puzzle, it's a very good thing to go and talk to other people, and then mixing all that together comes out with interpretation that works for everyone.
The logging while drilling was absolutely necessary. Like, it was one of the keys to the success of us achieving our objectives. But also, like, we were designing boreholes and redesigning things on the fly based on data that we were receiving in real time, and we were able to use the logging data plus kind of what we had so far from the course to make live predictions about what we were going to see next and adjust all of our drilling and coring parameters. And that was incredibly important for us to be able to target the intervals that we did and get the really good recovery on some of our key intervals.
I've never seen anything like this. This is what we came for, and it's been worth the wait. You know, we were hoping to get the core back with some basalt on it, but then to have all this extra stuff going on, this is what we were waiting for.
So once the coring operations are complete, the next phase is to install an observatory that's going to be measuring temperature and fluid flow across the prism and across the decolement. Both the logging and the coring data have been instrumental in helping us design that observatory. So the outline of the expedition was set up intentionally to have the logging while drilling first to give us that first look, and then the coring, and then use that to design our observatory. That was the reason that those operations were in that order, and we have been exactly doing just that, using our data to update every next stage of the operations.
So we've installed an observatory across the plate boundary fault. There are essentially a lot of super high resolution temperature sensors that we've strapped to a rope, tied them on, taped them on, hung them with a weight inside of a steel tube that goes down into one of the holes that we've drilled down across the fault. And essentially, they're measuring temperature over time at different places. The geologists on board see things when they go out in field exposures of veins going through. They think in their mind they have an idea of what may happen, of fluids moving through different places. We're seeing that process in real life.
So what we're doing on board is, in a way, very applied kind of geological, geophysical work that is addressing the fault and how the fault works as a system and what causes the earthquakes. But then if we can understand like what is the largest earthquake that could happen here and how often may it happen, then the people who plan the tsunami defenses might actually think about that when it comes to constructing those types of defenses.
It's not that we're just looking at rocks. These are rocks that have a meaning. And the meaning is that they're associated with earthquakes and tsunami. And the science that we learn from this hopefully can have an impact so that maybe we can mitigate that risk both here and in other places as well.
Around the Pacific Ring of Fire, see, there is many similar subduction zones. So this is a kind of very good example to understand earthquake process. And also looking at the Tohoku earthquake, tsunami is not only for Japan. The tsunami traveled to the other side of Pacific. So the understanding the earthquake around Japan also helped to the society all around the Pacific region.